Have you ever wondered how life is when you are a billionaire, especially in a country where there are many resources? A country where being rich is normal? If you ever have, then you are at the right place, because in this video, we are going to see how life is if you are a Qatari billionaire. Qatar is the world's wealthiest country, with a GNI per capita of $116,799, greater than any other country. It has greater oil reserves than all but two other countries on the planet, accounting for 13% of the global supply. The natural resource brings in tens of billions of dollars each year to a country with a population of fewer than 3 million people. Oil income is used to subsidize the country's government services. Petroleum accounts for nearly all of Qatar's exports, accounting for 87% of total exports. Qatar has one of the lowest unemployment rates in the world at 0.2%. Thanks to its strong economy, Qatar has a large number of billionaires. You must be thinking that what it is like to be a Qatari billionaire. Let us have a look at the life of some billionaires so we can get an idea. The son and subsequently brother of Qatar's Emir, Sheikh Khalifa bin Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, graduated from the University of Southern California and returned to the Middle East. He rose through the ranks of the country's internal security force and has developed a reputation as a jet-setting heartthrob. With over a million followers on Instagram, the dashing, goateed monarch has been seen yachting, driving costly automobiles, skydiving, and cuddling with young tigers. His college years in Los Angeles were the final chapter of a colorful life, and they would have remained that way if it hadn't been for a string of indictments by federal prosecutors in Boston last year. Although Al Thani and his family were not charged in the college admission scandal, the high-profile prosecution, which accused wealthy parents of conspiring to get their underqualified children into USC and other universities, prompted some who knew the prince to rethink the circumstances of his education. Following that, the New York Times received a tip to investigate his college degree. A millionaire trustee arranged a private meeting between the university president and the prince's mother before he started classes. And the university lavished him with special treatment after he arrived. He was given a master's degree for a period during which he took multiple vacations in Europe and never stepped foot on school due to dubious security considerations as an undergrad. His supporters went to extraordinary lengths to keep him happy, forging documents, breaking university rules, lavishing a golden camel statue on a UCLA dean, gifting a Rolex to a professor, and even buying a $500 gift for a DMV employee in order to secure a coveted vanity plate, according to accounting records and interviews. The Qatari government did not respond to demands for interviews with the prince, who is now 28 years old. His mother, an internationally recognized educational benefactor, or others associated with his stay in Los Angeles, David G. Keiko, a New York attorney who represents the prince, did not respond to dozens of written queries. Your study thus far has brought up suspicions, suppositions, and numerous levels of hearsay about matters that, if they did place at all, occurred years ago, he wrote in a letter to the New York Times. A spokesman for the prince, Max Schalklapper, stated last week that the questions posed by the Times were ethically insulting, if not openly bigoted. Would you be asking these questions if a white student was accused of missing class or being pulled over for speeding? Would you raise these questions if the parent of a white student reportedly gave money to a university to help it improve? Al Thani enrolled in school with his two cousins, Nasser and Jabir, who were part of his entourage. According to former chauffeur Martin Agabus and another employee who, like many of the prince's ex-staffers, spoke on the condition of anonymity to protect future job prospects. The prince rarely attended class after the first day at mission. International students were scarce. Only around 2% had student visas, and Middle Easterners were especially unusual, according to academics and staff. However, when approached by the New York Times, teachers and staff maintained they were unaware that Qatari royals were among them. His butlers stayed in $600 a night rooms at the Beverly Wilshire, while his half-dozen chauffeurs and security guards ate at the hotel restaurant, where a cheeseburger cost $30. The prince and his companions stayed in suites with rodeo drive views. An American who lingered on the outskirts of the prince's entourage was tasked with paying the bills. At Qatar's United Nations mission, Joseph Jurier, 60, had a number of positions, including Director of Public Relations and Travel Coordinator. He was labeled as a solution finder in his Twitter bio in 2018. He was charged in New York State of bribing a supervisor at JFK Airport with limousine rides, dinners, and a watch in order for Qatar to park its diplomatic jets overnight during the United Nations General Assembly, which was a violation of airport rules. Last year, the supervisor pleaded guilty to taking illegal gratuities and official misconduct. Jurier opposed the accusation and the prosecution against him was eventually withdrawn. Jurier flew to Los Angeles when Al-Thani moved into the Beverly Hills Shire and took on a job that was between fixer and babysitter. According to interviews with former employees and invoices examined by the New York Times, one of his jobs was to approve bills before they were delivered to the Qatari government. It wasn't always an easy procedure. The prince and his companions didn't want their exploits in America to be known back home. Jurier formed a partnership with Beverly Hills Rent-A-Car, a scrappy West Side outfit that specializes in renting exotic cars to tourists. The company began generating bills for the Qatari government for a variety of services, including a day rental of a Maybach $2,900, a security guard $600, a pair of cook assistants $475 each, VIP Disneyland tickets and tour $9,600, a Clippers VIP package $23,000, and a Lakers suite for $12,750. According to accounting logs and employee interviews, the invoice lasted for pages and pages, making it difficult for the Qatari government to uncover incorrect charges or exaggerated expenditures. According to the company documents, the vehicle rental service paid $200 for a Virgin Airlines flight and then charged the Qataris $8,700. According to corporate executives, the corporation billed $73,000 for legal services for a non-existent attorney. It's unclear whether the prince was aware of the billing details. According to former chief financial officer Mohammad Diakte and other personnel acquainted with the Qatari account, the overcharges established a slush fund that was used in part to pay for whatever the prince desired kept off the books. The car agency set aside $300,000 for the prince and his entourage to spend at the Vin Resort and Casino during trips to Las Vegas in 2014. According to records, despite the fact that gambling is prohibited in Islam and is illegal in Qatar, Al-Thani and his entourage visited Las Vegas frequently. According to social media posts and billing data obtained by the New York Times, the males were allegedly seen gambling on the casino floor, according to former employees. Some employees at Beverly Hills Rent-A-Car were concerned about how the firm handled Qatari billing. A former financial executive testified in a 2012 lawsuit against the corporation that the handling of Qatari cash was illegal. In a complaint filed last year, a former firm president claimed that the company issued fraudulent invoices to facilitate misappropriation of funds as well as to overcharge clients. Dykter, the former CFO, claimed that over his 8 years with the company, he became concerned that he was involved in flat-out fraud, one of many allegations he made in a lawsuit last year. Over the circumstances of his firing, he and the company are suing each other. David Sajassi, the prince's automobile rental partner, admitted in an interview that he hid charges that Al-Thani and his entourage didn't want their parents to know by categorizing them as other bills in the invoices. In another case, the Qatari emir paid a large quantity of money to purchase Six Island. The suitor is one of the world's wealthiest men, and the location is the poorest county in the Eurozone. However, in an odd convergence of economic circumstances, Qatar's emir, Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, has chosen to spend 8.5 million euros, 7.35 million pounds, on six lovely isles in the Ionian Sea. The deal's completion, the latest in a global shopping spree that has seen the Sheikh's property portfolio spread from London to Beijing, has been greeted with joy in Greece, the world's most bankrupt country, and Doha, where the royal household endured 18 months of agony to take possession of the outcrops. Greece is that kind of place. Ithaca's straight-talking Greek-American mayor, Ioannis Kassianos, stated, "Even if you are the emir of Qatar, it takes a year and a half for all the paperwork to go through when you buy an island." When the oil-rich monarch moored his superyacht in the turquoise waters near Ithaca, he took in the vista and liked what he saw. The isles, known as the Echinades, piqued his interest. It has been four summers since then. And when the king finally disembarked from the yacht, he asked about the pine-covered chain as he walked around Ithaca in sandals and shorts. Cassianos, a former US economics professor who took over as mayor of Homer's famed Isle 3 years ago, said they have a fund with a couple of hundred million in it. And as far as I know, they want to buy the entire group of islands, all 18 of them. The purchase, which is Greece's largest private investment, appears to have been a bonanza for the emir, who struck a hard deal in a market with few investors. The first island, Oxia, was originally listed for 7 million euros, until its Greek-Australian owners agreed to sell it for just under 5 million euros. Dennis Grievous, whose family has possessed the title rights to the other five since virtually the beginning of modern Greece, agreed on a deal last week. "The islands have been in my family for over 150 years, but we are no longer wealthy enough to be able to maintain such priceless estates," he added, bemoaning the skyrocketing taxes imposed on real estate by the crisis-hit Greek government. "We are ecstatic to see them leave. They've been around for nearly four decades. The uninhabited isles are a perfect opportunity for a solid business venture with endless potential," according to the high-end private island online portal, which describes the properties as Mediterranean pearls with their beautiful beaches, historic olive orchards, and natural coves. "The growth potential is enormous, from creating tourist-style club meds or hotel facilities to selling or renting villas." The Gulf Royals, on the other hand, do not appear to be in the mood to build terrorist resorts on the retreat. Instead, Cassianos stated that his goal to construct castles for the sole benefit of his 24 offspring and 3 wives, the architects have already moved in and are sketching up ideas for a private idyll, despite the fact that he has fallen into legal issues in Greece. "There's dumb law because we do everything backwards in Greece," Cassianos bemoaned. "According to the legislation, your home must be no more than 250 square meters in size, regardless of the size of your land." The emir has responded by claiming that his WC is 250 square meters and that his kitchen alone must be 1,000 square meters, since he cannot feed all of his visitors otherwise. The Qatari, who is also being courted by the government to invest in Greece, has vowed to come bringing presents to placate the locals. His people said, "What present can we give you?" And I told them the island solely needed water, Cassianos explained. A study is already underway to install a pipeline from the mainland. "When you consider that we've been trying to obtain a new port here for the past 40 years, that's not terrible." This summer, the emir intends to park his yacht off his new home. Ithaca residents are getting ready. Honorary citizenship is on offer, as well as a feast worthy for a modern-day Homeric hero. Qatar surely has some of the wealthiest people, and their life is also luxurious. We hope you liked today's video. If you did, don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel, and press the bell icon so that you can be notified when we upload our next video. We will see you in the next video. Until then, take care. Bye.